finally you talked about using the AFM for making measurements on the things that you put through the various techniques. And many of the results that I'll show are from IBM. Kumar Rivani is a research scientist at IBM. They use our systems for some really outstanding research. And Donna Hurley, who was a team leader at NIST until recently, she now runs a consulting firm called Lark Scientific and also helps us a lot with the applications development work. So thin films, you know, they're everywhere. Like whether you're opening a bag of potato chips, or you talk about photovoltaics, or you talk about implants in your body, thin films are everywhere. And they're on the order of, you know, a few microns down to just a few nanometers. And turns out that controlling the process for thin films involves measuring your films at many different steps in between. And AFM measurements, in terms of the resolution that you can achieve using the technique, they fall in that sweet spot where they're just perfect for measuring thin films, where the vertical resolution of an AFM is some nanometer, and the lateral dimensions you can measure are up to, you know, about 100 micron. And so we are in the appropriate lens scale, and the concept of, you know, designing your film down to the nanometer scale, even down to the single atomic layer, and, you know, designing it atom by atom is getting more popular. And AFM becomes more and more applicable as the right technique of choice when it comes to making measurements of films.
Now, I'm not going to go through how an AFM works,
but I would like to point out some of the limitations that has traditionally made AFM appear to be a technique of last choice. So when I was in graduate school, I used AFM, this is, you know, more than 15 years ago, where making AFM measurement was like watching grass grow. So you would set up your measurement, you would walk away for 20 minutes, come back, and you're lucky if you finished one scan. So AFMs have come a long way since then. AFMs fundamentally suffer from few challenges that asylum research has tried to address, and many of them very effectively. One is the resolution. So the instrument noise, improving the instrument noise, ultimately helps you get better and better resolution. The second one is the tip size. So it's not just about getting the sharpest tip, but it's also about maintaining the tip at the radius that you start. And this is important for getting repeatability in your measurements, because ultimately, you can only measure the quality of your films if you know that your measurement technique is not changing as you are measuring your films. And then the last one is drift and thermal variations. So many of the measurements can now be done using controlled temperature and controlled environment rather than just ambient conditions. And as you start making measurements at controlled temperature or environment, drift and thermal considerations become even more important. So techniques that allow you to maintain sharp tip, very good force control between the tip and the sample, and very good drift and thermal compensation become increasingly important. And the instruments that are available now are very different from what has been around for about 20 to 25 years. So many of you have seen other AFMs around. You know, the information in the previous slide, a presentation about 15 years ago would have shown the exact same slide and it would be appropriate. But what has changed now is AFMs can scan a lot faster. Many of the measurement modes are fully automated and yet can produce good resolution. And there is much more you can do with AFM than just topography. So there's more analysis features and there's also more types of measurements that you can make in the films. And one instrument in particular, the Cypher, I think some of you may have got a chance to pick up a brochure on your way in of the instrument, truly enables high quality measurements with ease of use. And the learning curve for using AFMs has improved significantly. So what are some of the cutting edge measurements that are performed with AFM these days? So the example on the left top corner is an example of how good can you get your vertical resolution to be. So the Z scale that you see in this image, this is an atomic or a molecular resolution image where you can see that the high resolution you're able to achieve is on the order of 20 picometers. Now 20 picometers a few years ago would have been the noise floor of most common AFMs, or even some of the very good ones. Now we have the ability to resolve down to that length scale. We can accurately measure roughness on the order of about 100 picometers. And we can do measurements on 2D materials like graphene, where we can get true atomic resolution on samples like graphene. So these are some of the things that have changed over time in terms of the resolution. And the other parts are, can you make these measurements in a more easy way? So any of you who have used AFM have gone through the painful process of aligning the laser, and it turns out to be the most difficult thing that you have to learn in using an AFM. So AFM laser alignment being fully automated is a good thing, which is what we have on the Cypher AFM. Now let's talk more about how you can use the AFM. So here's an example of titanium film deposited on a silicon wafer. Now traditionally AFM topography measurements have been processed to give you roughness measurements, and most common numbers people think about are RA and RQ. Now RA and RQ can give you some information, but there is many, many more things you can learn about a sample. So you would like to know what is the skew, what is the kurtosis, or you want to find all the different S parameters that are available that give you information beyond the simple RA and RQ of your film. So how would you go about making this analysis? So let me walk you through a few steps. So first of all, you start with a measurement, and your measurement may have some amount of tilt depending on the slope of your sample. So you would correct for tilt, and you would get numbers for roughness. Now in this case, the numbers you're getting for roughness are hundreds of nanometers. Now that's clearly not the right answer. And you're getting those numbers because the instrument is calculating the number for the entire image. And that is not what you would like to do. What you would like to do instead is find measurements for each region separately. So you can use an automated histogram mask and remove either the silicon component or the titanium component and get roughness on any one region. You can go further and apply histogram masks and now start to get more information about specific regions. Now in this case, we are looking to get information from the titanium region, and now the numbers are much more believable. And a typical process of analyzing your measurement would involve doing all of these steps, but in an automated way. So the analysis software and the AFMs made today allow you to do all of these steps in a fully automated way. Let me give you another example of when an AFM is useful in understanding your film deposition process. So in this case, chemical vapor deposition of a film was done at different amounts of time. And at 120 seconds, the roughness that you generate is very different from the roughness you generate at 600 seconds. So this is, I would call, a routine application for AFM, where you can study the roughness of your film with a change in the amount of time you deposit the film. Now we can add a level of complexity and say, I want to study the effect of temperature in the measurement. So there were a lot of questions around what would happen to the film deposition at different temperatures. Well, you can study that. So once you create your films at different temperatures, or if you would like to do an in situ measurement and study the effect of temperature, you can do measurements like in this paper by Namodaran. You can study that at different temperatures, your films grow in a different way. And you can actually plot the roughness versus temperature for films with different thickness and get some useful information of what would happen to your films at different temperatures. Now going one step further, what about controlling the environment around your sample? So whether the films are grown using an electrochemical process or they are grown in a controlled environment, the instruments are capable of creating a hermetically sealed cell and passing gases or liquids that you desire. And you can do some really interesting experiments where you can see controlled deposition rates, you know, single atomic layer at a time by doing a controlled experiment in a sealed cell. So in this example, every subsequent AFM image was laid on top of each other, and we can visualize a single screw dislocation frame by frame, and then lay all these images over into a video. And you can then reverse the voltage and cause an etch to happen when you remove all of these films. So it's a pretty interesting example on how you can use temperature and environment control to study these processes very accurately and with a lot of detail. Now, I'm going to show you an example of measurements done at even faster speeds. So in this example, each AFM measurement was taken in a matter of few seconds. So more recently, this year we announced our fastest AFM that allows you to do measurements at the video rate. And here's an example of CTAP, micelles growing on the surface. So once the micelles are laid on the surface on graphene, we find that on one side, the micelles take some time to get into a stable state. So as we image at a very fast rate, we can actually see the micelles migrate on the surface. And on the other side, the micelles seem to be stable and stay stationary. So this is the first time when somebody has observed real-time migration of micelles on the surface. We can also monitor electrochemical processes in situ. So in this example, changing the conditions caused the change in the roughness, and different monolayers were grown on the surface. So you can see a correlation between the roughness and how many monolayers were grown on the surface done in situ on the AFM. So electrochemical AFM capability is available on all the silent microscopes, and you can operate in a wide range of pH and do some interesting measurements of in situ characterization while changing the pH. Now, everything I have shown so far, it has just been topography. So you would ask me, well, the title of your talk was more than roughness. So can you show me data that is beyond topography? So now I will get into some examples that show measurements that are done by AFM that go beyond just topography. And one obvious benefit of AFM is the ability to do electrical measurements. Now, AFM measurements involve touching a very sharp tip on the surface. And you can take advantage of this local tip-sample interaction and make some really interesting measurements. So there are measurements that allow you to study things like breakdown of dielectric surfaces, conductivity of thin films, and all of these measurements measure the current. There are measurements that allow you to go beyond current and measure capacitance and resistance, a new technique called scanning microwave impedance microscopy, and there is a technique called Kelvin probe force microscopy that allows you to study the work function of the different materials that you put on the surface. So let me just share a couple of examples. So in case of scanning microwave impedance microscopy, you can study at the nanoscale the permittivity and the conductivity of your sample. So any of you who are working on RF circuits, as your dimensions get smaller and smaller, and you would like to study the performance of your devices at gigahertz frequencies, this would be a pretty interesting technique to try out. KPFM, here's an example of KPFM measurement on a film that has been grown with different conditions in different regions. And a KPFM image allows you to quantitatively map the work function differences at different parts of the sample. So in this example, you can see that there is work function differences at all these different regions on the surface. Now I'm going to spend the rest of the time talking about a specific example. So these are measurements done by IBM. And their aim was to come up with a way to speed up their process development. So the traditional process, which took several weeks of processing to arrive at the right chemistry was sped up. So I'm going to go into more detail on how this was performed. But before I do that, let me quickly explain to you what was the technique they used with their AFM. So they used a technique called conductive AFM. Conductive AFM is a very straightforward technique. It involves a sharp tip that may be metal coated or is conducted some other way, and applying a DC bias between the tip and the sample and measuring the current that flows from the sample into the tip. This allows you to do a two electrode measurements with nanoscale resolution. And their original process involved, you know, taking the wafer to the Stanford NanoFab, processing the wafer, doing 20 more steps of processing, and then using, you know, bulk analysis that you would use to characterize the IV performance depending on what film you deposit. So in a matter of a week, they would be able to decide whether the film that they deposited was the right type of film for developing the non-volatile memory. And if it's not the right type, they would go back and change the chemistry. Now, they had a plan to go and do this about 200 times with different materials. So imagine doing this over a week. If you were going to do it for just one type of sample, 1 week is not too bad. But if you have to do it for 200 different types of chemistries, you take 4 years to complete this experiment. On the other hand, when the measurements were done with an AFM and conductive AFM, they were able to short circuit this process significantly. And you know, every few hours, they could go back to the lab, come to the AFM, place a sample, do a quick conductive AFM measurement, and essentially do the same electrical characterization that they did with bulk techniques using the AFM, and get back with an answer within a few hours. So going from 1 week to about 3 to 4 hours per measurement, they're able to speed up their process development. And while this is not the most, you know, most beautiful or the prettiest looking AFM measurement you've seen, this is a real world example where an industrial application where you can save time and money by using AFM for your process development. Now, conductive AFM has been around a long time, but traditional AFMs perform conductive AFM in a way that is not appropriate for the type of process development work that IBM wanted to do. So in a traditional AFM, conductive AFM technique is treated as an exotic technique and it's not fully developed. So there are specific problems about how the AFM probe passes the current onto the amplifier and how those connections are made. There are problems around the change in the coating thickness as you scan the surface, and the reproducibility of your IV measurements is not very good. And the last problem is whether you make a ohmic contact from your sample into the AFM, or if most of your measurements are now coming from this contact resistance between the sample and the steel cup on which your sample is mounted. So IBM went in and worked on all of these things. So on the Cypher AFM, the electrical contact between the AFM tip and the electronics to do conductive AFM is done very differently. It's much more robust. They switched from using metal-coated probes to solid metal probes.
And they figured out a much better way of making an electrical contact from the bottom that involved something very simple. All they did was scratch the backside of the silicon to remove the thin oxide, and this improved their measurement quality significantly. And so what they were able to do is to
start from one chemistry, deposit the surface, do RDS measurements, deposit the film for conductive AFM analysis, do the IV measurements, and repeat that 200 times. So in a matter of 1 year, they were able to identify two or three candidates for the ideal materials that they need that showed the right electrical properties to develop their non-volatile memory process.
Now, once you know what films you're going to use, the next step is to convert those films into actual devices. Now, once you convert things into actual devices, AFMs are again going to struggle. And now this is where the drift performance and the thermal characteristics of the AFM become important.
So when you create a matrix of devices, devices, where you have thousands of devices in just a few microns of area, how are you going to take an AFM tip and go line by line? Are you going to have an operator that applies an offset each measurement at a time and measure thousands of devices? If that's the way you're going to do the measurement, that's going to take tens of years. So the next challenge was to automate the
measurements of the devices. And so the way this was performed is, they started with an AFM image of their devices. They came down with either a solid metal tip or a much harder diamond-coated tip that made a robust contact.
And they went in and did IV measurement at every single contact with full automation. And once they had selected the right film for the process, they got excellent yield. And in some cases, they got, you know, every single device performed as per expectation. And they found that the expected IV performance was good for 100% of the devices. So these are 1,200 IV measurements laid on top of each other. The other interesting thing is they found that the leakage current in their device was less than their expected 100 picoamp. So with this level of data, they were confident that they could scale this process and actually go to production. Now let me show you a video of how a typical measurement is performed where over 1,200 locations are measured. So the first thing I would ask you to do is notice how this sample is slightly tilted, so it's not exactly straight. Now what happens in this case is the instrument starts imaging from the bottom, it scans all the way to the top, it automatically identifies the angle correction that you need to make in the sample. Once this angle correction is made, so let's see, so if you notice the last column over here, and the one over here, you notice there's like maybe less than a degree of error. Now, it would be okay if you were just doing one or two measurements, but if you want to automate and measure every single point, a half a degree of error will cause you to, you know, really miss out some of the devices on top. And once the AFM finished correcting for the error, the pattern recognition function in the software will automatically identify the location of the devices. So let's see. Okay, so each and every device now has a number associated with it. And now the instrument can go and start making measurements. So the tip goes to the first location, and it will start performing an IV measurement. So this is the first IV measurement. And they set a criteria, a pass-fail criteria, where if the gap between the voltage going from 0 to negative versus 0 to positive was a number more than a certain amount, then they would mark that as red. And if it was within the acceptable range, it was marked as green. So for each and every device that had 12, for each and every circuit that had 1,200 devices, they would get a visual indication of where all the good devices are and where all the bad devices are. And they can then go back and do a cross-sectional TEM directly on the bad device and do a physical failure analysis to understand which one was the failing device, as opposed to a technique where you operate inside an SEM and you do nano probing device by device and try to find the bad device. So this saves them, you know, months of time and cost. And being able to do this in a fully automated way in a few hours for thousands of devices was truly a game changer for the process development that they did. And so in just a few seconds, you'll see that it finishes measurement and it quickly identifies the bad ones, which they can then go back and take care of using physical failure analysis. So this is an example where AFMs can be used for industrial applications to really save cost and time. Now I'm going to show you another example. This is around DNA nanotechnology. Now DNA nanotechnology, for those of you who are not from Caltech, was invented at Caltech by a guy named Paul Rothman. And so he brought this sample little over 5 years And it's a pretty incredible concept where DNA can self assemble on the surface, and you can essentially produce any kind of pattern you like. And the implications of this technology are, you know, in electronics, in DNA sequencing, there's lots of really cool applications. And one nice thing about the Cypher instrument is it has resolution that can go and see each and every individual view of the DNA. So going from a resolution where you measure, say, half a micron image down to a 60 nanometer image and seeing each and every individual view. Now, this is great. This measurement was done a few years ago. Now, we had a professor come from the Netherlands, also working in the DNA nanotechnology area just this month. And we have some interesting results to share. It's not in a slide. So using the Cypher video rate scanner, we are now able to image the same kind of sample at video rate speeds. So typically what happened before is ATEMs would measure the before and after state. So you would insert a solution on the surface, the DNA self-assembles, and then you take an image of the surface. What nobody has done so far is see in real time what are the steps the DNA takes when it reassembles on the surface. So in this experiment, square DNA origami was on the surface, and a trigger molecule was injected that causes the square DNA origami to become rod-like. So let me go back and have you focus on, let's say, one origami at a time, okay? So just observe this guy, and I'm gonna speed up the movie so you can see. So we start with a square origami, and the stuff in the background is not noise. These are single DNA fragments that are not converted into origami. And you notice that this starts to form a little tether, and as you keep imaging, at some point, it changes conformation, and it's undergoing a process of rearranging itself into a ribbon, and then it finishes. So the same thing is happening in different places. So now focus your attention to right around here. And you will see how a square DNA origami changes into a rod-like structure. So this is the first time. These results are not published, and so they're not in my slide, but we believe this is the first time somebody has seen DNA origami self-assembling on the surface, and not just a before-after image. So again, a nice application of AFM for DNA nanotechnology. Thank you.
Yes.
So with the conductive AFM, one other application is actually nano-oxidation of surfaces, silicon surfaces in particular, but you do lots of other surfaces.
Yes.
So have you used your Cypher system to do any rapid writing via conductive AFM into, you know, let's, for instance, creating oxidized hieroglyphic images on the surface of silicon, things like that?
Yeah. So anodic oxidation using AFM is a nice technique, and one of the things we have found is that controlling exactly the humidity between the in the environment around the tip and the sample is very important in deciding what is going to be the thickness of the lines or the patterns you create. So we have a setup that allows you to, we call it microangelo instead of microangelo, where you can import a bitmap, control the humidity level, and control what patterns you would like to make on the surface, and it actually automatically goes in and starts making some of these measurements. And I can show you some examples of, you know, like complicated bitmaps like Mona Lisa being put on like a 1 micron image. Where would this be? So we do this all the time as a fun activity, but I'm not necessarily sure how this is scientifically relevant.
Well, we use it, we've been developing techniques that allow us to post-fabrication trimmer type.
down to the contact level. We have measurements on carbon nanotubes, and I actually have some of the data that I can show you right now. One of the challenges in that technique is still getting the probes to be as sharp as possible. So the best resolution in scanning microwave measurements right now is about 50 nanometers. And occasionally you will see results that are about 30 nanometer resolution. But getting the shielded probe with a very sharp tip at the end that is reproducible right now, the state of the art is about 50 nanometer resolution.
Do you make those tips or do you source them from elsewhere?
We source them from elsewhere.
I had a question about controlled environment,
yes.
AFM. You showed a cell where liquid or gas was being put in,
yes.
And the tip is immersed in
yes.
that as well. Okay, but there was some plating and coating going on. I was wondering what was happening to the tip in all that time. Was that getting plated and coated?
Probably not, since the tip is always at ground, but you can change the bias on your sample. To make sure that your experiment is happening only on the sample. So what we are doing is we have a controlled environment. We can either have liquid or gas or both controlled simultaneously. And to make sure that your sample is the only one changing and not the tip, you can use applied voltage as one of the controls. But it's a good question. If the deposition is something that happens everywhere, then there is no way to prevent the tip from getting coated as well.
Would you know it had happened?
Yes. So you would see a change in the resolution almost immediately. If your tip ended up getting coated, then you would see a change in the resolution.
Yeah. Any more on AFM? Okay, let us move seamlessly. Yes, thank you for that presentation. There's a great video. And let's move seamlessly to